Hey, good morning, everybody, and welcome to the vlog. Hope the start of your day is absolutely incredible. You know, over my life, I've been called a lot of different things. Yeah, a lot of different things, but lately, I've heard more and more that people are referring me to the Bob Ross of reptiles. And I'm not gonna lie, I'm not mad about it. And the truth is, I actually do look at us as living artists. That's right, we basically take different color palettes and we take different morphs and we mix them together to try to produce beautiful creations like this pastel Soul Sucker Russo, which is basically a pastel hidden gene het Russo. Absolutely gorgeous. But oftentimes these animals come from just our own minds, right? What we think the possibility and the endless kind of amount of colors and mutations and patterns that we can actually create. And I tell you what, I've been doing this a long time and it never gets old. So just like any artist, you have to understand your palettes, right? You have to understand your colors and how they interact with things. And when you want to make a beautiful snake here, like this pastel calico yellow belly, you have to understand the palettes that go into it, right? So we're gonna start with a pastel. This is just a normal, incomplete, dominant animal. And it's a beautiful animal that increases yellow, makes things a little bit more blushed out. So you wanna take that animal, and then you're gonna wanna put it into a calico. Now the calico is that animal that has a little white blotching in the sides, and it actually is, again, an incomplete, dominant animal. So you can actually produce animals like this with white. You can mix that together, and then you can add one more gene, which is a yellow belly gene. And you can see the belly is a little bit yellowy, but also there's flaming up the sides. So what you do is you start mixing all three of those morphs together, and you can produce, of course, this beautiful creation, this work of art, living art, which is a pastel calico yellow belly. And that's how it all works, right? It all starts kind of with the vision and understanding the palette of colors and patterns that you're working with, and then creatively putting them together in hopes to produce my Mona Lisa, which of course are these beautiful animals that we create every single year. And although our easels may be living animals, and we have to certainly understand that there is a life there and we appreciate them as animals, the truth is that we're trying to also create the most beautiful possible work of art that we can in this living body, right? I mean, how amazing it is. It may not just be about pulling out a blank slate and just drawing or painting away one afternoon. It may take us years, maybe sometimes 7, 8, 9 years to actually realize the creation of what we have in our mind. But when we finally do, it's absolutely breathtaking. This happens to be a banana leopard Enchi clown ball python, and oh my goodness, take a look at that. I mean, it's amazing. And again, over the last 25-30 years, it's incredible how far the hobby has come when it comes to this living art. And I'm actually, for one, very grateful to be a part of it and to have kind of seen it right from this beginning, to see how amazing these animals are. And if I can be anything like Bob Ross and inspire an inspiration to love reptiles like he inspired people to love art, I'll tell you what, I'll take that title any day. So just like art, it all starts with a blank canvas. And our blank canvas when it came to ball pythons was this right here, a normal wild type ball python. And by selectively breeding things, all we're doing is taking away or adding proteins that are different pigments, different colors, different patterns, and stuff like that. And you know, it's pretty amazing, because when I started this journey, when I was just a kid, literally, our blank canvas was basically all we had. And within a few years, the only thing we really had were a couple mutations to start this amazing journey. And one of the first mutations that was ever produced in ball pythons that really got it started was, of course, the albino ball python that was produced by Bob Clark. And it was back a long time ago. And they were $15,000 when they were first born. Pretty amazing. But again, this is kind of what started the journey, you know, seeing an albino. And honestly, we all understood what albinos were, so that wasn't a big stretch when it came to the imagination. And then entered the piebald ball python with Peter Call, of course, that proved it genetic. And this was really an interesting animal, because again, it started to take away color with white blotching. And when the first pies were actually introduced into the country, a lot of people thought it wasn't genetic. They thought it was maybe an incubational flaw, like maybe some fungus on the egg caused pigment to be reduced. And when it was actually proven to be recessive, everything started to change because now you started to have albinos, pies. By then, pastels and spiders started to come around and other mutations like ghosts and hypo ball pythons. And now you started to have a pretty cool color palette to start working with. What would an albino bred to a pied look like? And you have to remember, you know, these things take time. So we didn't know what an albino pied was even gonna look like, right? And because they were recessive mutations, you had to breed an albino to a pied and get normal looking babies that are what they call double heterozygous for both albino and pied. And then there's something that's called Mendelian genetics. That is basically just the odds of producing the double recessive mutation. In this case, it happens to be a 1 in 16 odd. And then eventually, someone was able to produce the first albino pied, and it looked like this. And it represented the colors perfectly, right? You had the orange and yellow of the albino, but you had the white blotching of the pied. And that's really how it kind of started, right? People started to think like, wow, now we can mix things and actually start turning what our visions of this color into actual living art. And it's been an amazing journey to come this far. And so I'm just gonna go ahead and own the Bob Ross, and I'm gonna do a little Bob Ross impression. Of course, what we have here is a beautiful white and normal colored piebald ball python. But you know, wouldn't it look nice if we added a little smiley face right there? Just an eyeball, and a smile right there. And how about this? How about if we added an eyeball, and a smiley on the other side? Wouldn't that make it happy? And enough screwing around. The truth is like I said, I've always been a huge Bob Ross fan. I really have. I've loved the guy since the beginning. And I think it's actually funny that people would think that I somehow have the same attributes. You know, I think the fact that not only was he so passionate about art and all that stuff, it made you want to do it, right? Like every person that watched Bob Ross wanted to take out an easel and actually start drawing, you know what I mean? And listen, I obviously tried it a lot of times and I wasn't very successful. I can honestly tell you, I'm a lot better at breeding snakes than I am painting. There's no doubt about that. But it was cool to have a guy like that that inspired a generation to get into art. And I can only hope that I make even a little bit of an impact on people to get into not only keeping and loving reptiles, but maybe even breeding reptiles, because it is really truly an amazing experience. But it's still just funny to think of a little bit. And I definitely miss those mornings, those Saturday mornings, waking up and seeing Bob Ross, you know, doing that stuff, painting those happy trees. And you guys know that occasionally I'll sport a Bob Ross shirt too. But the truth is my easel is right here, right where I'm standing, right? And the work that I put into this of what males and what females go together and how I'm actually gonna hopefully be successful each year, not only with, you know, breeding the animals, but then hopefully hatching the animals. And listen, luck goes into it too. I mean, when you have beautiful animals like this killer leopard clown being bred to another animal that's another leopard pastel clown or whatever, you know, you got to get a little bit of luck too, right? It's not just like mixing purple with this color to get this color. I mean, the fact is that we have to sometimes just get lucky and hit the right odds on things too. But the truth is that the work that I put in right now, that's really where it really comes down to, right? You know, making sure the right males are in with the right females at the right time, because if I can't do that, nothing really matters, to be totally honest with you, does it? And literally, we're at that time of the year when it's super crucial to do the right thing. I mean, to have the right animals in with the right animals at the right time, because this is kind of that critical month and a half. I always say that there's certain times during the breeding season that is like super critical. This is one of them. And then the other one is towards the end of the breeding season when it's super important to not miss a breeding or miss a feeding or whatever the case may be. But listen, we've got a long way to go. This is the first crucial month and a half coming. And then again, maybe 2.5 months from now, it's the second critical side of it. And I tell you what, if we can keep the motivation, we can keep the passion, we can keep the excitement, the enthusiasm for coming down here every day and switching our males and getting females together. And listen, I don't think that's gonna stop. It hasn't stopped in the 32 years that I've been doing it. Believe it or not, this is my 33rd breeding season that I'm starting right now. So I don't think I'm gonna lose focus on it now. And listen, it should be a really fun year this year. Last year was amazing. This year is even better because we have a lot of cooler animals to produce. So it's gonna be an awesome time. I cannot wait to share it with you guys. But yeah, this is my Bob Ross moment and I'm gonna own it. And I know I've been talking about ball pythons, but the same goes true with any other snakes or reptiles or any animal for that matter. Remember, all these things are made up of proteins that are made up of colors. And it's insane for me to think that a reticulated python could be white with black freckles all over it, like my girl Perdita here. I mean, this is one of the most stunning and beautiful snakes I have ever seen. There's no doubt about that. And again, just unbelievable living art. And I just am so happy that I've been able to be a part of seeing the kind of whole revolution of producing these incredible animals from back when I was a kid, seeing only wild-caught, normal reticulated pythons, and now seeing so many people producing these amazing animals. It's ridiculous. So I am curious though, do you really think that I am like Bob Ross? I mean, what would you categorize me? Let me know in the comments. Like I said, I don't take advances. As a matter of fact, I own it. I think it would be amazing if people really did think of me that way, but I am curious. Is that an accurate depiction of actually who I am? And again, take a look at each and every animal, even their wild type color like Nova here, or of course, Bred Lope, the Doomerals boa. It never gets old looking at these animals. Night Fury, the beautiful black iridescent snake, Gramps, the albino king rat snake, or even, you know, the craziness of the color and pattern of course, Ben and Jerry. Even though they have two heads, they're still beautiful, gorgeous animals. And that's one of the things that I am always blown away by. Look at the blue green basilisk, which I love in this new enclosure. They're doing so well, they're getting big. It's gonna be so awesome to see these guys produce in the future. So again, these are really all living art. I mean, look at the emerald tree boa. I mean, just look at that animal. Again, the dart frogs. I mean, how crazy can think of nature can be, you know, the colors of poison dart frogs. But that's what it's all about, is just being excited. And if I'm the Bob Ross, I think Bob Ross was super excited about the things that he was passionate about, which was art and bringing happiness to people. And that's really all I'm looking to do with all of these amazing animals, is to bring happiness to people that come to the Reptarium, bring happiness to you guys that are watching, and try to bring kind of a renewed excitement about these beautiful animals. And again, they are living art. I mean, look at Daisy over here. I mean, I could never have imagined an albino reticulated python when I was a kid looking like that. So it's pretty cool. I mean, look, nosy bee panther chameleons. I mean, are you kidding me right now? I mean, this is a living animal that you would find in the wild of Madagascar. I mean, I will never cease to be amazed at how insane these animals actually are. And if I have to be a little goofy every now and then to bring that to you, I don't mind it, because the truth is, I am a goofball. And this is Bob Ross signing off for you guys here. Hope that you enjoyed the video. If you did, could you do me a favor? Hit this playlist right over here. If you watch one, two videos, it helps my channel a tremendous amount. So please do that if you don't mind. If you don't mind, also subscribe to my podcast channel up here, as well as help me get to 3 million on this channel by subscribing. Turn all your post notifications on. Have an absolutely wonderful day. Remember, be kind to somebody, and I promise I'll see you tomorrow.